you, Lord. Just bear with us a few minutes. We're coming home. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Welcome to Shut In With God this evening. This is Prophetess Linda Chance and Apostle Edward Chance.
Yes.
Coming to you from Soaring Eagle Ministries International here in Echo Ridge in Scottsdale, Arizona. And we just want to welcome you tonight, those on Periscope, Facebook, our tribe from Soaring Eagle Ministries. We want to welcome all of you tonight and just say God bless you. We love you. We're so glad that you were able to join us tonight. So as we worship the Lord by Jesus Culture, walk with me for a few minutes. Go ahead and invite your friends and share the program because I really do believe that you're going to be blessed tonight. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We just want to welcome Pastor Edward. I see
yes.
Mary from North Carolina.
Great, Mary.
Welcome you tonight.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
There's Carol, one of our spiritual daughters. God bless you, Carol.
Carol with a Y?
Yes, it's Carol with a Y. She's with us tonight. Amen. Amen. So worship the Lord with us for a few minutes.
Andreas joining tonight.
Yes.
Good to see you.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord. David, good to see you tonight, my brother.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Good evening, Pastor Edward.
Thank you, Virginia Lynn. See you tonight. Hallelujah.
Another one of our spiritual kids.
Amen.
Yes. Yes. Hallelujah.
God's going to speak out tonight.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
God bless you, Periscope.
Hallelujah.
Glad to have you tonight. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Wonderful Lord and Savior, our Redeemer. Yes, praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's what we're doing tonight. We're praising the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Invite His presence tonight.
Yes.
Invite His presence.
Yes. Jesus Christ is Savior. Amen.
Amen. Invite His presence tonight.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So go ahead and invite your friends. Amen. And share the program. Hallelujah. Some people might not even know there is a share button, but there is. And just go ahead and share the program because we're going to be blessed tonight, all of us. Yes, He died for our sins. Amen. Amen. Yes, He did. Hallelujah. We're so thankful. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. There's Minister Evie. God bless you tonight. Hallelujah.
Thank you,
Lord. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you. We hope you all had a wonderful day today. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Yes, it is.
No one else made it.
No one else made it. That's
true. Amen. Then He put us in it to live. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
That abundant life.
Yes, yes.
Amen.
Yes.
That abundant life. Thank you,
hallelujah,
Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Good evening, Rose. Good
Rose,
to see you tonight.
God bless you. Another
blessings.
One of our spiritual daughters. Amen, amen, amen. We are so blessed, Apostle, aren't we?
Amen.
To have all these spiritual children and natural children.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, amen.
That must be the reason I feel so old. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, my goodness. We're not old. We're young. Amen?
Amen. Just getting started. Hallelujah.
Yes, we are.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Blessings to you, sweetie. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you, Father. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Well, again, we just want to welcome you tonight to Shut In With God. And like I said, I'm Prophetess Linda Chance, and this is Apostle Edward Chance, and we're from Soaring Eagle Ministries International in Echo Ridge in Scottsdale, Arizona. So we just want to welcome everyone tonight. Amen. And tonight, we're going to be talking about life of a covenant walking church. And that's what God desires. He desires for us to be in covenant, not only with him, but with one another. Amen, Apostle?
Amen.
It tells us in Hebrews 8 and verse 10, "For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. And I will put my law into their mind and write them on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Amen. Isn't that a good thought?
Yes,
hallelujah.
It is.
So you might be saying tonight, if you have never been taught about a covenant, you might be saying, "Well, prophetess, what is a covenant?" Well, a covenant is simply a binding agreement. When you join a church or become a member of a local church, you're actually coming in agreement with that body and the teachings of Christ. And once you do that, you're now in covenant relationship with your brothers and sisters in that local church.
That's right.
And you know, there's a good example in the Bible of a covenant relationship, and that was between Jonathan and David. And also another way to look at a covenant is when a man and a woman gets married, and they say their vows. They're actually making a covenant
before God.
Amen. Before God and all those that are sitting there watching them. Amen. So all that God does is based on covenant. So when we get saved,
that's
we come
right.
in agreement with God. He
that's
becomes
right.
our God, and we become his people.
That's right.
You know, we see covenants both in the Old and the New Testament. And it is through these covenant relationships which collectively serve as the foundation of God's promises to bring redemption to his people, that we can understand the advancement of his kingdom. And so as we come in a covenant relationship for one another, we begin to advance God's kingdom here on earth. Amen.
That's right.
And you know, religion doesn't work, but relationships is. And that's what we're talking about tonight. We're talking about having a covenant relationship with God and with others. So Jesus and the 12 were in a covenant relationship.
Yes, they were.
As they walked together for 3.5 years. Amen. And in the Word of God, there are several covenants in the Bible. And of course, we're not going to be able to, go through all the covenants. But five covenants that are crucial for understanding the story of the Bible and God's redemption plan. And we're just going to talk a little bit about these. Noah covenant is the covenant that God made with Noah. And then the Abrahamic covenant was the covenant that God made with Abraham. And then the Mosaic covenant was the one that God made with Moses. And the Davidic covenant is the one that God made with David. And then, of course, the new covenant, the one with the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the one that we're in. We're in this covenant, amen, if we're truly serving the Lord. So again, like I said, we don't have time to go through all these covenants, but you might want to study these on your own, amen. It's just wonderful to see how God moved in the Old Testament and the New Testament through covenants. So throughout the Bible, God related to his people through covenants and still does.
That's how he works.
In other words, God says, "I will be your God if you will be my people." And so when we got saved, we come in agreement with the Lord. Amen.
That's
hallelujah.
Right.
So a covenant is a promise made to humanity by God as revealed in Scripture. The agreement between God and ancient Israelites, in which God promises to protect them if they keep his laws and were faithful to him. Apostle, in biblical times, garments were exchanged to represent covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
That's right.
And the exchange of that garment meant that a person took on the other person's identity.
That's right.
And so when we become saved, we come in covenant with the Lord Jesus Christ, and then we begin to wear his robe of righteousness.
That's right.
We are one with him.
Take
Amen.
Taking on his identity.
Yes, taking on his identity. And this is what covenant is all about. So we just want to look at some scriptures tonight as we talk about walking in a covenant relationship with God and others. Amen. And so as we go through this study tonight, we want you to remember that we're talking about a church that is walking in covenant. This is the desire of God for the apostolic church to be walking in covenant with one another. This is what kingdom people do. Okay.
Amen.
Okay? So Ephesians 4, 2 and 3 says this: be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace together. So we're talking about covenant people, bearing one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace together. And so covenant people keep their focus on God, Apostle, and this keeps them in the right place and doing his will.
That's right.
And doing his will.
Amen.
Too often we focus on what God wants us to do when he is concerned more about who we are.
Who we are.
And about godly character.
That's right.
Amen. Godly character. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. And so a covenant people are, listen, this is a really good word here, and this was Apostle that said this. It says, as a covenant people, our being should always be based on our doing. Think
right.
of that. Our being should always be based on our doing. You know, our actions tell who we are.
That's right.
Saints, are you listening to me? Our actions tell who we are. You know, I have watched people. Their actions reveal who they are.
Mm-hmm.
We need to ask a question tonight. Who are you? Or who am I? Who am I? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let's be able to say this. I'm a covenant walking person. That's who I am. Amen?
And each day, you know, you're coming more and more like Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Living this life of Jesus Christ in the earth
yes,
today.
Yes, yes.
Another thing is, you know, as we continue to walk into the body of Christ, the mm-hmm. covenant relationship with each other, with the Lord, and the purposes and plans that he has for our lives. And, you know, in our relationship, we have a responsibility.
Yes, we do.
We have a responsibility.
Yes,
a lot
do.
Of Christians don't really realize that they have a responsibility to walk in a covenant relationship with each other.
Right.
And there would be so many less fights and troubles if people remember that they're in relationship, and they should be gentle and kind and in peace to one another.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Another thing that God says is to be, of course, you've already mentioned that, is to be what? Humble.
Amen.
Humble. Wow. Amen.
That's a good one.
Oh, you know, mm-hmm. sometimes we want to reverse it. We don't want to walk in humility. We want to walk in, in this, and with our feelings on our sleeve, more or less,
yes.
I'm saying. But be humble.
Yes, be humble.
You know, and I find that people that want to be humble, and maybe we may be having some areas in our life where we're trying to come into that place and the enemy is fighting against us. And I'm sure you know this, but to be humble, the Bible says in Proverbs 25 and verse 9, he guides the humble.
Yes.
What does that tell you about those that's not humble?
Mm.
He guides the humble in what is right. What is right?
Yes.
If you're trying to do things wrong, God can't guide you. But he guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his ways.
Amen. His
teaches
ways.
Them his ways.
Ways.
You know,
yes.
it's much easier to teach a humble person than it is a person, like I said, always up in the air, always mad, always angry, always resisting, always criticizing, you know, always running away rather than submitting. And so, but God wants to cultivate in our lives humility.
Yes.
And two of the ways we can cultivate humility in our lives, he said, what do I do? Well, one of the ways, how can you not cultivate humility in your life if you pray each day, each night, or several times a day, or and also study the Word of God.
Yes.
If you're doing these things, you will find yourself mm-hmm. becoming more and more humble.
Yes, amen. That's true.
Rather
that's
than
true.
Becoming more and more resistant.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. So the Bible says also we ought to always pray. And so
yes.
if we always pray, and then it's certainly going to have an effect in our lives, and how we minister and greet and deal with other people and in relationship with other people.
Yes.
Amen. And so, and with our nation, our cities, whatever it may be, we'll address them or come in to them with humility.
Humility, that's right.
Another thing about being humble is, as I said, prayer of this word. Because if we're praying God's word, and when we're going through trials and troubles ourselves, we'll understand there is a need for God in our lives, and there is a need for His strength and His wisdom
yes.
as we walk with
yes.
Him, or even yes. as we deal with other people in life.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever found this out, that you need God's strength and you need God's wisdom to deal with other people in life sometimes?
Yes,
amen, because you know, you like to just sometimes just take them by the neck and shake them, but you got to do it a different way. Do you understand that?
Be humble.
Be humble.
Yeah.
Amen. And so, amen. But also another thing is to be grateful.
Yes, that's a good one.
I'll tell you, I, the older I get walking with God, the more I realize how grateful I should be.
Yes.
Grateful for the life He's given us. Grateful for our health. Grateful for all that He does for us. Grateful for the friends that He gives us. Grateful for the church that He's put in our care.
Yes.
Amen. For the people.
Amen.
I'm grateful for our family. And so the list
yes.
could go on and on
yes.
and on of being grateful. You know, sometimes people are not grateful unless something just great happened for them. That is not the place to walk
no.
with God.
Uh-uh.
Amen. Because, you know, we're walking humble, down rather than up.
Yes.
And so being grateful in good times, bad times. And that's what God is looking for in our lives, that we can be grateful. Now, I want you to think about that for a moment in your life. Maybe you're going through some hardships. I've been going through hardships for a long time. And, of course, personally, I know some of you are going through some hard times.
Yes, yes.
But I know also at the same time, you look at God and say, God, even though my life right now is pretty hard, but I want to tell you, I love you and I'm grateful
yes.
for not only what I can see, but I'm grateful for what I can't see.
That's right.
What I can't see, because I know you're working your purpose and your plans out in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And that is so important. Now listen, let me give you another scripture. In the early church, we're talking about a covenant loving people, responsible, walking with each other.
Yes.
And so if you can't be a long ranger and walk in covenant with people.
Amen.
Amen. And so here is God. Here's God in 1 Thessalonians 5 and 8. Give thanks in all circumstances. What?
Wow.
Are you practicing this? You have to practice what the word says.
Uh-huh.
You can't just say it. You've got to practice it.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to go through it. You've got to be what? Thankful the circumstance you're going through right now. You said, I don't like it. Well, start being thankful.
Yes.
And it'll change.
Yes, that's right.
Amen. First of all, it won't be as hard as you make it to be if you start being thankful.
Yes.
So give thanks. Give thanks. God, I know you're in control. I look to you. My focus is on you. So give thanks. Given and God's work, God's there's a process that God is working out in your life. There is a maturity. There's a place that God is at in your life to cause you to grow in hard times. To grow in hard times. If you can't grow in hard times, how are you going to help other people?
Wow, that's
amen.
True.
So we want to be thankful in circumstances beyond our control. And we find in that early church about people's trust, their character, their honesty. Because see, in a church, you look around for people that's qualified. Let me say that, qualified,
yes,
fit
yes.
for the master's use. I'm not looking around for people who's not fit for the master's use. I'm not looking around for people who's not qualified to do what God wants them to do. Sometimes we just think, well, God can just use me any old way. Well, you need to go back and reread the Bible.
Yeah.
Amen. And sit down and start praying about it. Because we find in the early church, when they had a need in the church, he says the people chose when they widowers were, you know, some widows were more favorable, it seemed like, than others. And it became a problem. And when there's a problem, we got to address it and we got to resolve it. You get that? We got to resolve it. And we find if you're going to resolve problems, you got to have people that's planted in the house of God. And the Bible says, know those that labor amongst you.
Yes, yes.
Thank know you. Those. Not just somebody passing by. Nobody just throws $1,000 in the offering plate. You don't know them. You don't know them. It's good they do that, but you don't really know them. And so people in early church, whenever the problem in the church, because they were in covenant relationship. Did you hear what I said? They were in covenant relationship and they've proven themselves.
Yes.
What? Proven themselves. Before the body and for the apostles, they had proven themselves.
Yes.
And so they looked around and said, you need to choose seven men that can take care of this problem. And the Bible says in Acts 6 and verse 3, brothers, choose seven men from among you. Seven men among you. Didn't say seven men outsiders, but seven people that's in covenant relationship in the body of Christ. Those are the ones that you want to trust. Those are the ones that you believe God wants to use. And so, brothers, choose seven men from among you, known. What? Known. There's a key. Known. To be full of the Spirit and wisdom, and we will turn this responsibility over to Him.
Yes.
Now, this is the kind of church that we're working on and raising up in Scottsdale, Arizona. That's going to be a church that can take over responsibility.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And we look at responsibility in every area in your life. Now, some of you, I may rub wrong sometime because I'm looking for responsibility. And I'm also looking for the way that you respond and that you answer. If you got a horny spirit, if you got an attitude about things, well, you're going to need some more work in your life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Amen. Grab that. Grab a hold of that. Grab a hold of that. Sometime, and God has
got
everything
it.
Working for our good.
Yes, He
Amen.
Does.
Amen. For our good. But you know, sometimes people, they get very discontent because things are not progressing and moving along as quick as they want it to.
Yes.
So what happens? They get discontent.
Mm-hmm.
And I find people get discontent. Pretty soon, they're going to find another church.
Uh-huh.
They break covenant relationship, first of all. Amen. Okay, first of all, you wasn't planted there.
All
you
right.
wasn't planted there.
Help
Amen.
Us.
You were there just to see what's available for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so, okay, I want you to just grab that, okay? Grab that.
Yes.
Just grab a hold of
yes.
that.
Right
and
God.
So if we've been content, now here's a key. If we've been content, here again, grateful, humble, we've been content. Maybe everything's not always going to be perfect. Don't misunderstand me. But if you're being content and realize that this is where God placed you, then you're teachable.
Yes.
You are what?
Teachable. Amen.
Because I find people that's teachable also as people that's grateful.
Uh-huh.
Rather than, I don't like this and I don't like that. I don't like the way the preacher preached today. I don't like what the apostle said. La, da, 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 da. You know what? You need to shut up and you need to go and pray somewhere. Hey, that's what you need to do. You need to humble yourself. You need to realize what God is trying to work in your life with that little attitude and spirit that you already rebelling.
Yeah.
You already rebelling and don't even recognize it.
Yes, yes.
Oh, I know sometimes I'm sort of just... bang, hit the target. But you know, I don't know. What's the sense of shooting if you don't hit the target? Amen. And another thing, and we've been addressing this a little bit here lately, and I want to thank all of you that's been faithful in your tithes and finances. And I don't make any bones about this. We're not doing this thing for free. Come on, somebody. I quit doing this thing free a long time ago. Amen. Hallelujah. But Hebrews 13 and 5 says, Keep your lives, and some still are not free from it yet, but keep your lives free from the love of money.
Mm-hmm.
People that love money will not tithe. I promise you, They will not tithe. So keep your lives. And God is saying, if you're not, money can control you. It can control you. It can control what you want, where I'm going to go, what I'm going to do. It's all, the money is all about you. Just like the guy in the Bible, when Jesus came in, the rich young ruler, and the one thing he couldn't give up was his money. Amen. Good to see you, Tina. God bless you tonight from Connecticut. And so he says, keep your lives free from the love of money. Now listen, I know the Bible says money is the answer of all things. Don't miss, I haven't found myself throwing money on the sidewalk anywhere.
No.
And I don't think any of you either. But we have to use money wisely, and we have to use it wisely according to the word of God. When we in covenant relationship is when the blessings of God begin to kick in for us.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
That's so true.
So keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God says, I will never leave you or forsake you. Now, let me tell you that I got a couple of things. Let me throw this in, then I want to say something else. So it says the love of money is the what? The root of all evil. And so there's a root in your life that is evil because of the money.
Mm.
Hey, get it. Amen. I didn't write the word of God. God did through holy men of old. And Paul is teaching us when he's talking about money in 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. He says money is a test of your sincerity. It tests your sincerity. Amen. It says a soldier doesn't serve at his own expense. It's like, let me ask you, sir, is any of you working at your job at your own expense? Do you not expect a salary or a paycheck at the end of the week or 2 weeks or whatever? If you don't, you can't survive, can you? You got a family to support, children to put clothes on their back, send them to school, all kind of bills pile up in at your residence. Amen. And so you have to have the funds, the income, because of your labor. I said, because of your labor. Let me say it again. Because of your labor, your 40-hour work week or your 60-hour work week. Amen. As you travel up and down the roads, you punch the clock, whatever the case may do, you expect a paycheck. Amen. And so ministers are no less than you are. This is a job. Amen. You can slice it, dice it. You can make it sound good, but it comes down to the fundamentals. It is ministry, and when you say the word ministry, it is a job.
Yes.
We're doing a job tonight. Mm-hmm. We prepared for it yesterday and today. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody just give me an amen. All right, go ahead.
God bless you, Marlene.
Amen. Marlene.
We're so glad to have you tonight.
Now,
amen.
So let me say, preachers are not about money per se, but they know it takes money to live. Amen. And over the years, I think we've proven that we're not about money.
No.
Amen. And Prophet Brayman, to a point, I remember years and years and years ago, as I was preaching on San Carlos and this minister came up, he said, would you come and minister to us? And I said, sir, I said, you realize, I said, I'm a man of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so he said, because he said, I'm a Baptist brother. He identified him earlier. But I want him to know now, I don't mind coming and ministering if that's what God wants. But you just have to realize I am a Holy Ghost preacher. Amen. Holy Ghost preacher. And so don't expect me to come no less than being a Holy Ghost preacher. I'm not coming as a Baptist preacher. I'm coming as a tongue-talking, spirit-filled, Holy Ghost preacher that believes in signs, wonders, and miracles. You know, to have it, God does amazing things. And you know, our car broke down.
Uh-huh.
Of all things, our car broke down. But I knew another minister that had a giving heart. Come on, another minister had a giving heart. He said, hey, him and his wife, hey, we'll take you to it. Me and my wife. And you know, I didn't realize at the time, it was 8 hours one way going to that meeting. 8 hours. Way out. And if I had to go today, If my life was on the line, I'd probably have to die because I don't know where it was at. Anyway, we got a map. We found out where it was at. It was somewhere way up in Navajo Nation. I've been way up there. We found it just about 30 minutes before service. I'm getting ready. I'm all ready. You know, I prayed. My brother's driving. Man, I'm just in tune with God. I'm ready. And God spoke and God says, He turned my message all over, upside down. He said, I want you to preach on the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I said to God, I said, God, this man already told me these people have the Holy Ghost. But God says, no, you preach on the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Have you ever argued with God?
No.
Or have you talked with God? And if you really listen to God, God's going to have his way. And so I obeyed the Lord, and I preached on the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And boy, people were responding. People were hungry. And my wife said over 50 people got the baptism of the Holy Ghost tonight. And it wasn't just laying hands. I mean, it was a sovereign move of God. Did you know that that preacher got mad with me?
Yes.
And he took up an offering for us. He said, I'm taking this up for the preacher. And he took the offering up. And you know, people were giving. When you get the Holy Ghost, there's a spirit of giving in your life.
Yeah.
And they gave. He went to his, went over to the place. And, you know, we were staying in his house, him and us and this other couple. You know, he didn't come around us. And I thought, wow, that's sort of strange. We got up the next morning, and he was sitting out there under the brush arbor, and we just drove up to say goodbye, and so he never said anything about money. You know, I'm not going to beg. I'll tell you the right way, but I won't beg you. I'll tell you the truth, but I won't beg you. I'm not going to beg any person or any man or any family, amen, about money. God is my supplier. He is the one that's always came to our rescue.
Yes, he has.
We drove all, we went up there and talked with him. He was nice, smiling. He didn't say one thing about the money he took up. We got in the car and drove off. Got back home. Our rent was due on Monday.
Yes, it was.
And you know, when we went to the mailbox, there was a letter from a doctor somewhere in New York that I've never met, don't know how in the world, New Jersey.
Yeah.
I don't know how he got out my number, he got an address, and all of this. God has an address, amen.
Yeah.
So I don't know how it happened, but he sent us a nice check that covered our rent and had a little left over.
Yes,
isn't God good? When the minister became a thief, he stole God's money.
Whoa.
I said he stole God's money.
Yeah.
And you'd be surprised sometimes that ministers are stealing God's money. I don't want to ever be accused of that.
No.
Amen.
And you know, Apostle, covenant keeping people will not
Was that
do
good?
That was good.
All right.
That was good. It wasn't good at the time. It was sad. We felt sad.
Amen.
Not because of the money, because God was revealing that.
Well, not only because, but see, we needed the money.
Yeah,
we
did.
We needed the money. We spent 8 hours one way, 8 hours back. We preached, we ministered, all these things. We worked hard, and we should have been rewarded.
Yes.
That's what the Bible says. We should have been rewarded. Amen. But that's okay. Amen. God's good, isn't he?
Yes, God is good. And God knew the man's heart, and he knew he wasn't going to give anyway, and he spoke to someone else in New Jersey to
And
give.
God sent us anyway. Of course, people still got blessed.
Yes,
people
yes.
still got the Holy Ghost.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
You know, I have a word tonight. I don't know who this is for, but, you know, the next topic we're going to be talking about is being obedient to God's revealed will. And I just have this word for someone, refuse to get out of the will of God.
Mm-hmm.
Refuse to get out of the will of God. Be careful of strange voices. I keep hearing that. Be
All
careful
right. strange
of strange voices.
Voices.
And I want to share something that happened several years back. We were having some kind of a function. I don't remember what it was. But we were having some kind of celebration. And this man, this minister, another minister, he came with one of our spiritual sons to the function. And we had a young lady on, well, she wasn't real young, but she was young in the Lord and being trained to be a prophet.
Mm-hmm.
And she was really doing good. God was really moving in her life. And so this man called her aside and told her that she was being held back. She
mm-hmm.
was being held back. And so she came and told us about what the man said. And we just, you know, we told her, we said, well, you know, you're not ready to be sent out yet. You need to continue. She was in the school of ministry. But to make a long story short, she didn't leave right then, but later on she did leave. And the last time we heard about her, she wasn't even in church. She's not even serving the Lord and not doing what God called her to do. And so I just want to say to you tonight, be careful of strange voices. People will speak to you and get you out of the will of God.
She wasn't planted and rooted firmly in the word of God.
Yes.
Amen.
But we're talking about covenant people tonight.
That's right.
As covenant people, we're supposed to be obedient to God's revealed will. And we need to be careful about whose voices that we are hearing. And I want to say to you tonight that he will reveal his will and purpose for
yes,
your life.
He will.
It might not be just to you. He could reveal it through a prophet or an apostle or your pastor. But he will reveal God's will in your life if you allow him to. Hallelujah.
Those we bring into the house of God that minister to God's people.
Mm-hmm.
We want them speaking into God's people's lives. We want to hear what they're saying. Amen. Isn't that right?
That's right.
Thank you, Lord.
And the scripture tells us in Jeremiah that he has plans for us, and he will reveal those plans to us if we wait on him. Amen? So we want to be obedient to God's revealed will. Hallelujah. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and make us realize what is wrong in our lives.
What is wrong?
Did you guys get that? He will reveal what's wrong in our lives. So,
and that's not bad, is it?
No,
it's
not.
That's not
it's
bad.
Correct. It corrects us when
right.
we're wrong, Apostle.
That's right.
And teaches us what is right. That's the word of God. And true covenant leaders will make sure that they teach you the truth. They'll teach you right from wrong, just like we do, our natural children as they're growing up. We teach them right from wrong because we know that one day, they will be out on their own. And that's the same way with our spiritual sons and daughters. Amen?
That's right. Growing
Hallelujah.
Up.
Amen.
Growing up
so,
in the faith.
So God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. Every good work.
Mm-hmm.
And we went through this a little bit last week, but covenant people must be connected to a local church.
Come on.
Must be connected to a local church. I hear people say, well, I just go wherever the Spirit leads me. I don't really belong in a church. I just wait for the Lord to speak to me, and he might tell me to go over here or over there or over yonder. That's not a covenant relationship. That is not a covenant
That's
person.
That's a dangerous person.
Yes.
To the local
that
church.
Is a dangerous person. And you know what?
Did I call them spiritual vagabonds?
You did.
The other week, I think. Amen.
You did. And not only that, Apostle, they become praise for the wolves.
That's right.
Without a shepherd watching over
Come
them.
Come on.
Amen. So what we're saying tonight, saints, we need one another. The body of Christ needs one another, and we need to be I've got it, honey. We need to be watching over each other also.
That's
you
right.
Know, now,
Come
not
on.
Only are we in covenant with God, but we're in covenant with each other. Amen.
That's
Hallelujah.
Right.
So I don't know what happened here.
Right,
okay.
Yeah.
Hebrews 13:17 says this. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their life. Listen to me. Watch your leaders. Watch your leaders. Consider the outcome of their life and imitate their faith. Obey your leaders and submit to their authority. You know what? They keep watch over you as men who must give account
That's right.
to the Lord.
That's right.
Excuse me. So, as covenant people, we must relate to the fivefold ministry in the local church.
Amen.
In the local church, it tells us that in Ephesians 4:11-12 that God gave the fivefold ministry. He gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to prepare God's people for work of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Built up. Amen. Think about that. Those whom God has placed over your life to train and equip you for the work of the ministry. Hallelujah. And you know what? We need to thank God for these gifts. These are gifts from God.
That's
hallelujah.
Right. From
and
the Lord.
And we need to honor them and thank God for them because they're watching for your soul. Not only are they training and equipping you, but they're watching for your soul.
You know, prophets, the Lord knows what will work, doesn't he?
Yes,
and he also knows what people need.
Yes, amen. But you know what, Apostle? Many people have a problem with authority.
Oh, yes, I know.
You know, in the local church, they call it control. They call it control. Mm-hmm. Many people, if you're not in a covenant relationship, you will not like authority.
Especially they want to do what they want to do. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You know, those who God has placed, again, over them to watch for your souls. And I want to say this to you too. This is a word of wisdom right here. You will never be able to lead until you learn to follow.
That's right.
You will never be able to lead until you learn to follow. Amen. So Apostle, many people have a problem with their tongue against their leaders, mm-hmm. or their brothers and sisters in the local church. See, that's not covenant relationship. That is not covenant relationship. Amen. And this should not be so in the covenant church. Amen.
You know, the Lord hears. Mm-hmm. He sees, he hears.
He does.
He hears the words you speak.
He does.
He sees your attitude, your actions. God sees everything.
Mm-hmm.
You're not fooling him. Amen.
The tongue corrupts the whole person. Listen to me. The tongue corrupts the whole person. It sets the whole course of his or her nature on fire.
Mm-hmm.
And it itself sets on fire by hell. It comes from hell. This is not coming from God. So the word does tell us that no man can tame the tongue, though God can. If we allow God to help us, God can help us tame the tongue. And so sometimes it's best not to say anything at all.
That's
amen.
Right.
Sometimes it's best just to change the subject.
Hold your tongue and pray. That's
yes,
right.
Change the subject too. Hallelujah. You know, especially right now when people want to just argue and be so mean and ugly, just change the subject. Just turn the subject off and start talking about something
mm-hmm.
else. Or walk away. Or walk away. Do you hear me? Or walk away. And so many people, they have a problem also with their attitude, Amen. We don't need to be, as covenant people, have a problem with their attitude. We need a sweet spirit. Like Apostle
right.
said earlier, we need to be humble. Humble. So if your attitude isn't right, nothing else will be right. Hallelujah. Have you ever got up one morning and you just got up with a bad attitude and the whole day went wrong? I mean, it just seemed like everything happened went wrong.
Oh, my goodness.
That's
oh,
because
yes.
you were out of order. You were out of order. You should have took time to pray and
with
said, God, help me with this attitude, you know, amen.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, I know people, I've seen people down through the years that had talents and gifts, but God couldn't use them because of their attitude.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That's a shame,
ambush
isn't it? Ambush
your own lives.
Yes.
Lives.
Hallelujah,
amen.
Because of their attitude.
You know, if we,
us, Lord.
As we walk as covenant people, we have such an advantage over people that don't know the Lord. Think about it.
That's right.
We have such an advantage over people that don't know the Lord because we're in covenant relationships.
Mm-hmm.
But number one, because God has placed in us an open counsel, open godly counsel.
Right.
And of course, mm-hmm. we want always people to know here at Soar Eagle Ministries, for those that are in relationship, covenant relationships with us, you always have the door open for godly counsel. Amen. So, and some of you have taken advantage of it, and we appreciate that, and we're thankful that you have confidence that God will help you through family issues or marriage problems or mm-hmm. Whatever the case may be. You know, it's a list of things. And it can save us a lot of headache and a lot of failure in our lives. And listen, you fight the same devil we fight. And so with that being said, the devil, it always is attacking God's people.
Yes.
But I hope you do know enough today to say, Satan, get me behind me. And if that's not enough, then seek godly counsel mm-hmm. to help you through that ordeal, whatever you may be going through. It's not a crime to seek godly counsel. God encourages us to seek godly counsel.
Yes.
Now, if I'm going to give you godly counsel, it's going to be done face to face. I'm not going to try to give you godly counsel on the phone. Amen. And so, but it, see, it is so important for us to have godly mentors and people that will help us navigate through this old fallen, crazy world that we live in today. Proverbs 12 and verse 12, Proverbs 12, chapter 12, verses 15. The way of a fool, and it's hard to say the way of a fool. But you know, you can't tell a fool anything. You can't give a fool any advice. And what I've learned in life, when I find a fool, I just leave him alone.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Have at it. Just
good.
Go ahead and have at it. Amen.
Knock yourself out.
Knock yourself out. Amen. The way of a fool seems right to him. So if says it seems right to them, you can't tell them anything.
No.
They're already convinced.
That's right.
I'm right, you're wrong. Okay, well, we'll see how that works. But a wise man, and we're looking for wise people in Soren and Good Ministry, the wise man. But a wise man listens to advice.
Yes.
Listens to advice. Realizing that's the right way.
Mm-hmm.
I understand things more clearly. And we can change. And that's fine. That's what God wants. And God also wants us to be spiritually minded. Found in Romans 8, verses 5 and 8. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their mind set on the natural desires.
Yes.
On the fleshly.
Uh-huh.
But those who are spiritual live according to what the Spirit wants, how has in mind. And I believe that all of God's people in Soren and Good Ministries and throughout the world, I hope you're living and being prepared for what the Spirit has in mind for your life. Amen. And so God wants us to focus on spiritual and eternal goals in life. If you just focus on today, if you just focus on just only on the natural, you are not focusing on things that really you should be focusing on. Yes, there's a natural world we live in. Yes, there's a material world and we live in. But we should minimize this world of the natural that we live in. Not to say we don't need money. We don't need all of these things in our lives. But we can't just entertain these things. Amen. So now God tells us, and two, when we talk about that, if we're just living in the natural, we can't just be living for self.
That's true.
Am I just living for self? Or am I concerned about others? Now, the Lord tells us, and I didn't write that in Scripture, but I think it's in Matthew, the 6th chapter, that when we get up and pray, our Father which is in heaven,
uh-huh.
Our Father which is in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Mm-hmm.
Your kingdom come. Your will be done.
Yes.
You see where we put ourselves, mm-hmm. when we're talking about spiritual things versus natural things? Because the Bible says, even before we come to God, he already knows our needs.
Yes, he does.
Think about that. He already knows our needs. As is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our debts as we have forgiven. Forgive our sins as we have forgiven others' sins. Lead us not into temptation. Do you pray each day, Lord, don't lead me into temptation. Don't lead me into temptation,
oh, yes, Lord.
But deliver us from evil.
Yes.
So we pray this seemingly a simple prayer, but listen, if you're really legitimate, if you're really sincere Christian, if you're really covenant related to God in the body of Christ, we need to pray this because you may have offended somebody. You may have sinned against somebody. So God tells us that we need to make sure that we're doing the right thing.
Yes.
Amen. You got something to say?
Hallelujah.
You're back to here.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
So, in other words, I'm saying God wants us to be kingdom-minded and not just fleshly-minded.
Yes.
So many people, and sometimes when we come into the house of God, first say, we may be to be fleshly-minded, but I do believe that people really get converted, become kingdom-minded.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. Also, Apostle, God wants covenant people to be committed to excellence.
Excellence.
Yes,
I love
excellence.
That.
The definition of that is the quality of being outstanding or extremely good. Amen. Mm-hmm. You know, just doing it any old way is not enough.
Oh, I love that.
This is the kind of people I want on my team, those that have excellency, mm-hmm. or those that have an excellent spirit, amen, hallelujah. Those have a spirit of the quality of being outstanding and extremely good. If I'm going to pick a team, Apostle, that's what I'm going to be
looking
for.
Wasn't that the kind of man they were looking for in the book of Acts?
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Yes, it was.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
People
Thank
of excellence.
You, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to throw you off.
1 Philippians 1:9 says, and this is my prayer, that you may that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and in depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, and you may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ. Mm-hmm. Amen. Hallelujah. And also, covenant people must be wholehearted. Must be wholehearted. In other words, you must put your whole heart in it.
Come on.
Be wholehearted.
Not
you know,
half-hearted.
Apostle, half-hearted people will never get the job done.
That's right.
Because their heart's not in it.
Because they're double-minded.
And you can tell when someone's doing something if their heart is in it or not. Amen? It tells us in Colossians 3:23, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart. Work at it with all your heart.
That's right.
As working for the Lord, not for men. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I'm working right now on my fifth book. And, you know, I know a whole lot more now than I did when I started out
doing
my first book. And I look at it, but I still, even though I know a lot more, I still want to make sure that, you know, whatever I say is from God. Not from
Amen.
My own spirit, you know, that God, whatever God is downloaded in my heart, and I want to be wholehearted about it.
That's
Amen.
Right.
Hallelujah. Do it for the glory of God. Whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. Amen. And you're not going to be ashamed. You know, God, you will reap the rewards from God, and he will bless you if you do whatever he asks you to do wholeheartedly.
Amen.
Amen.
You know, prophets, I've watched you over the years. And God, wow, I'm married to an author. But I've watched you over the years as realizing that God had called you to be an author, amongst other things. But I watched the dedication and the wholeheartedness of hours and hours of research and research and research and hours of hours of writing and metra or praying and seeking the mind of the Lord. Watch you get up at night, rise from the bed, go to the office. I don't even bother with you. I know God's speaking to you. You know, that's good to see. Amen. I know when you get these books or when you buy these books, amen, you get a book because God, amen, was able to entrust the word of God into actually an unknown. Nobody knew you when God said, I want you to write my word. I want you to write books.
Yes.
Concerning my will to the body of Christ. And so let me encourage you in all these books that she's already wrote. If you get each one and you'll pray over them. I'm not trying to sell something. I'm just,
Amen.
Well, I am because it's, that they were written in excellence. And we wouldn't take one, you know, God give us told us a long time ago. He said, one day you're going to have your own, printing company. And wow, really, how's that going to happen? You know, but sometimes God works things where he causes what he prophesied to you to take place. And we've hired this lady, actually way away, give her quite a bit of money to write the book.
Not to write the book.
Well, I'm to edit it. Publish it. But you know, and when she sent back the book, a fifth grader could have done better. It was not excellent. I would not put that out there and my wife would not put her name on it, something like that, and put it out there and say, and she was like, oh, it looks good. Lady, you don't have any access. You don't know what in the world you are doing, and you should not be taking people's money and claiming to be editor.
But you, she was an editor.
We got these
peanut
butter and jelly sandwich people sometimes. They call themselves all kind of people. But when you see the quality of who they are, they are not who they purpose to be. But if you will grab your money. And so there is where we started our
semi-publications.
Amen. Isn't God good? He took a negative, and I'm talking to somebody right now. And so sometimes when you reach seem like a dead end and people are not doing what they should be doing, maybe God said, hey, I've got a better way. And I'm really going to put you in control.
And you know what, Apostle? Not only did the Lord speak to our heart about starting our own publication, but he gave me my own editor.
Amen.
Sister Melissa, she's my editor. Hallelujah.
Lady of Excellence.
And she and I work together. I mean, we're just like what do you call something just works good together, Melissa?
Like a hand in a glove.
Yes, like a hand in a glove. And a mother and daughter team. And it's just, it's amazing what God will do if you allow him to use you.
But you know, we're giving God the glory, though.
Yes.
Only God could do that.
That's right.
But we have our ears open to what God is doing. Even though it took a long process of time to do it. Mm-hmm. That's when you can't just jump out there and do something. You got to wait upon God's timing. And it always will work. God's timing will always work. Our timing will always create a mess. And that's what I'm going to right now. Be patient. Be patient. Because
yes.
The Bible said in your patience, you possess your soul, your emotion, mind, and will.
Mm-hmm.
Come on now. And we know we all have one. Hebrews 10 verses 36. You need to persevere. When things are difficult, when things are not always easy, when it seems like there's no prospect of prosperity or things working out. That's what we had in this publishing company. And so you need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he promised. Mm-hmm. And so out of that dilemma that was very disheartening, God rewarded us with what he promised. And so we don't want to go through that heartache time and time again of trying to find somebody. Amen. So, you know, but Abraham and Sarah had a similar problem, not been an editor or anything like that. But they, had, of course, had a promise of God was going to give them a promised son.
Yes.
But, you know, Abraham and Sarah, a lot of it was like they forgot to continue to persevere and believe in God because they became to a place in their life. Listen to me now. I'm talking to everybody that has an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying to you right now. Sometimes we can come to a place in our lives that we're unwilling to wait on God's timing.
Uh-huh.
Now, I want to say something to you. And so instead of trusting God and waiting, they took the matters into their own hand. And of course, you know that through Hagar, a son Ishmael was born, not the will of God, but because a man and a woman got impatient with God and said, God, we can do a better job than you can. You just made a terrible mistake.
Yes,
and we know today the consequences of that action of Abraham and Sarah. And Abraham was a man of faith, the father of faith. But God put it in there. God put it in there to tell us you don't have to make the same mistakes.
Yes.
Did you hear me? You don't have to make the same mistakes. You can, but you don't have to. Let me tell you something about your mistakes. Sometimes mistakes can be forgiven and we can go on and it's under the blood and da-da-da-da.
Lord, hallelujah.
And then again, here's another reason you want leadership in your life to keep you from making those crazy mistakes that's going to last you for the rest of your life.
That's right.
Come on now.
That's right.
The enemy has traps out there for us, and he wants us to pay dearly. Listen to me. He wants us to pray dearly for the traps that he laid, and there are going to be consequences for the rest of our lives. Oh, yeah, it's under the blood. But you still pay the consequences.
Mm-hmm.
Abraham and Sarah did. We have the Jews and the Arabs still in battle today, and they will be until Jesus comes.
Yes, that's true.
Amen.
That's the word.
And also, we need to be also be open to unexpected things happening in our lives. Unexpected things that don't destroy us, but they come unexpected. Joseph was betrayed by his brothers unexpectedly. He was betrayed, but God saw him through.
Yes.
Abraham, but Elijah said, there's nobody serving God except me. But God had to correct him and brought Elisha into his life to walk in covenant relationship with him.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
That's true.
Now, God tells us in the Word of God, and it's 8 o'clock already. All right. Now, God tells us about the unexpected. He actually wrote it in his word to tell you, thank you, Mr. Clark. Let's let it have its say.
That's grandfather talking.
Amen. So, and I notice this is a long service. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9, it talks about the unexpected taking place.
Yes, it does.
I want you to write this down on Isaiah 58, 55, verses 8 and 9. It talks about the unexpected can take place because God said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. Put that in your spiritual vocabulary. Things may not work out the way you always, matter of fact, probably won't work out the way you think they will. Amen? Hallelujah. I think I'm back to you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, and another thing that covenant people must be, apostle, is they must be willing to suffer.
Yes.
Willing to suffer. And, you know, people don't want to hear this. We don't want to suffer. None of us want to suffer. But there is a certain suffering that we will do that is of God. That is of God. And so if you're in covenant relationship with God and others, there will be times of suffering. You're going to go through things.
Come
Amen.
On.
Hallelujah. Look at Joseph. Look at Esther. Look at Paul. Look at all the different ones in the Word of God. That there was times of suffering in the process. When God was making them, you know, and there is a time that he has to make the man and the woman before he can make the ministry.
Amen.
And so 1 Peter 4:13 says this, so then those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful creator and continue to do good. Maybe you're suffering tonight. Maybe you're going through some things. Maybe you just feel like giving up. But you know what? God says continue on and do good. Continue on and do good. You know, if you don't think you will suffer, you're in for a rude awakening. And I imagine everybody out there can say amen.
Amen.
So, you know, but we must not stop doing good just
That's
because
right.
we're suffering
stop.
Or going through trials and tribulations.
That's
amen.
Right.
Hallelujah.
He's working on the man.
Yes. Thank you, Father.
Working on character.
Yes. So the Lord will always be involved in our suffering. He will always
Come
be
on.
Involved as he was with Jesus.
Yes.
Amen. So there were times of suffering both in the Old and the New Testament. You know, and another good thing if you don't think that Christians suffer, you need to read the Fox's Book of Martyrs.
Yes.
That will open up your eyes. Amen. Mm. Hallelujah. So the Bible tells us that we learn obedience by the things that we suffer. Amen?
That's right.
Hallelujah. And then the next thing, Apostle, is to be bold for Christ. Be bold.
And you're suffering, you're going to be bold, huh?
Covenant
Amen.
People must be bold for Christ. We can't be little wimps. We can't stay hid, you know, in the cave forever. There comes a point in time that we need to stand up for what's right. We need to stand for truth. Amen. Hallelujah. Stand up for what's right in the eyes of God. Not be afraid to speak out. Hallelujah. Holy boldness. You know, there's many leaders tonight that are afraid to speak out.
That's right.
They're afraid they will lose some of their people. I say we should do what Jesus did. Hallelujah. We should do what Jesus did. You know, he would speak out against injustice. He would speak out against injustice. And so should we.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. So we gotta be bold, and we can't be ashamed of who we are and who we serve. You know, I used to work for the state of Arizona, and it was amazing that I worked with some people for years and did not know they were Christians. did not know that they were Christians mm-hmm. because I call them closet Christians. So you know, we talk a lot about the gays being in the closet, but a lot of Christians are in the closet too. They're afraid. They're afraid to come out. They're afraid of persecution. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think some of them are even afraid for people to know who they are. They're afraid of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, that's a nice excuse, isn't it?
It tells us in Mark 8:38, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous mm-hmm. and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be afraid of him when he comes in his Father's glory with his holy angels. Saints, we must speak out. We must stand up. We must be bold. We must speak truth, amen, in this, like the scripture says, in this adulterous and sinful generation. You know, we are those lights that Jesus Christ said would shine in a dark place. We are those lights. And so we need to shine for Jesus. We don't need to be shameful of who we are.
That's
or
right.
afraid to speak up who we are.
That's right.
You know, I'm proud to be a daughter of God. I'm
That's
proud
right.
to be a handmaiden of God.
That's right.
I'm proud to be a prophet of God. You know, it don't matter what people say. It don't matter what man says. You know, I stopped doing that a long time ago, Apostle. I never was a man pleaser. You can't be a God pleaser if you're a man pleaser.
That's right.
So the Word of God, and also God is speaking tonight to us. Be bold. Stand up for truth and stand up for the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory
you know,
to
isn't
God.
Isn't it amazing? The world's wow. not ashamed of the devil they serve.
No, they're not.
They're not ashamed of the devil mm. they serve.
Yes.
And so we shouldn't be ashamed of the Savior that we serve
that
tonight.
We serve.
Because
Amen.
As you said, we are a witness. We are light
right.
on a hill that cannot be hidden. That others can see that they can be saved.
Mm-hmm.
That they can see a difference in the world. They can see that it does make a difference to be saved.
Yes, it does.
Amen. It does make a difference. And so, again, in closing tonight, be willing, as you said, be step out in faith. Because the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Mm-hmm.
When you step out, you have to do it in faith.
Yes.
Amen. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Earnestly seek him. That's right, Brother David. We've got to be that voice. That voice. That voice in the land. That voice
yes,
around sinners. Amen.
Amen.
Around sinners. Those that there's a possibility of them getting saved.
Wow.
We are the communicator between heaven
yes.
and the earth. Amen.
Yes.
Thy will be done on earth. Our responsibility is on earth.
Yes. Yes.
On earth.
On earth.
Get it. Our responsibility, when we pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, is responsibility on earth,
mm-hmm.
what we hear heaven saying.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
And you know, and
thank you, Lord.
We have seen over the years, and I probably should just stop there.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
No, let me go a little further. Amen. Sometimes we, sometimes people, a lot of people sometimes are presumptuous.
Mm-hmm.
They're very presumptuous.
Mm-hmm.
They presume. They don't hear God, but they presume God said something.
All right.
A lot of people today in wrong places, doing wrong things because they presumed that God said something. They didn't hear God, but they wanted to hear God say what they thought he said. And so,
yeah, that's true.
And I know that God many times has, over the years, taken us and many journeys through life, and I'll tell you what, we did not even know how God was provisions that God was going to have, but God's always been faithful to
yes,
us.
Yes,
but
yes,
don't
yes.
confuse faith with being presumptuous.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do it. You will just enter into your worst nightmare of confusing faith with being presumptuous.
Yes.
And presumptuous has been very dangerous. We got to make sure of what God is saying versus what the enemy is trying to say.
Yes,
definition
right.
of presumption is an idea that is taken to be true, often used as the basis of other ideas, not known for certain, assuming not good enemies. It's enemies' trappings.
Yes, thank
we
you.
Just assume something. I'm mm-hmm. so thankful that the Lord said to me when we first came here, he said, don't be presumptuous about nothing. Don't assume nothing. Boy, what a good word. What a word of wisdom. What a word that would guide us. What a word that will lead us, because you can assume or presume a lot of things that God is not in.
That's true.
It can be very expensive. Mm-hmm. I think it can be very expensive.
Yes.
If I'd have listened to some people, I'd have been in a world of hurt right now, and maybe in a building. See, they're presuming God wants you to have a building. God wants you. No, I gotta hear the voice of God.
I gotta wait
upon the Lord, because He's got that right place, that right place.
The perfect
timing. That perfect timing of God. And we're not gonna run out and get ourselves in debt we cannot manage.
That's right.
Amen. I said that we cannot manage just by being presumptuous. Here's what I believe in the covenant relationship, in closing tonight, walking together as covenant people, found in Ecclesiastes 4:12. Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves.
Yes.
A threefold cord is not easily broken.
Broken.
That is talking about covenant relationships.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we'll continue this at another time. I've got another message in that, but we'll stop there for tonight. Amen. We're talking about covenant relationship with you,
yes,
God's people,
yes.
You at Soaring Eagle Ministry.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. And so we want to thank God for you tonight. We want to thank you for your prayers, that you keep us in prayer, covered with prayer. We also ask you to continue to keep our sister, Millie, in prayer tonight. She's come down with the virus at her work. And so keep her in your prayers. The best we understand right now, they're giving her antibiotics.
She's
in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And God's people are covering her with prayer. So keep
yes,
her, continue
yes.
to keep her covered with prayer.
Yes.
Prophetess, I want to ask you tonight
Lord.
To go in prayer. Just pray for all the needs of people tonight. If you have a need, just say to God what your need is tonight. He hears you. He is not deaf. As she prays, God will respond. God will meet those needs. God will come to your rescue. God will change things. It's unchangeable. Amen. God will continue to let you see the kingdom of God in your life. Amen. And you will see His miracle working power in your life. God is not finished with you. Yes, thank you, Lord. I'm hearing right now, the Lord said the enemy has really been at somebody to tell you your life is over. It is not over. You may be in a mess. You don't know how to get out of it, but your life is not over. God, He said, I have the way. Call unto me and I will answer.
Yes.
Call unto me. You call unto Him. And God said, I promise you, I will answer you. I will give you step by step to walk out of whatever that dilemma is, whatever that circumstances is. No matter what it may look like it is impossible, but God specializes in being a God who does the impossible.
Yes.
Now, let me say, you also need to be doing your part. You need to be doing your part, amen. But God is a miracle-working God tonight. I've seen Him. We walked in it. We received it. We'll receive it again. God is who He says He is. I said, God is who He says He is. I want you to believe that He is who He says He is tonight. Amen. If you can put faith in who He says He is tonight, you will see the hand of God. You will see God's hand in your dilemma, in your circumstances, where no man can come. No man, but God says, I can.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Oh, bless your holy name tonight.
Hallelujah.
Father, we thank you, Jesus. I'll just go ahead. Father, I release your anointing. I release your power tonight. Lord, that you would minister to the needs of your people, that you would touch their hearts, no matter that dark place that they may be. That God in that darkness, they're going to see the light of the world tonight. They're going to see, oh man, their Savior coming to their rescue. God said, I did not bring you to the place you at. Amen. To leave you in a place where there is no hope.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus Christ tonight.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Minister Evie is saying that she's believing for
thank you, Jesus.
Tonight.
Glory to God.
Father,
thank you,
you
Jesus.
Right now, Lord.
Yes,
God,
thank
we
you,
come
Lord.
In agreement with our
thank
sister,
you,
Lord.
Jesus.
We're believing for a miracle.
Thank
Father,
you,
God.
Jesus.
Lord,
glory
you know,
to God.
You know what she has need
thank
of,
you,
Lord.
Jesus.
And so, Father,
glory
we just
to God.
Decree it to be so.
Thank
Lord,
you,
Lord, in the name
Adam
of Jesus,
Adam
God, we speak healing over Millie tonight. Father, we decree that she will live and not die.
Yes,
Father, we thank
you, Lord,
that your hand is upon her, Father God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, that you're moving by
your
Spirit on
tonight.
Her behalf,
thank you,
Father
Jesus.
God. Lord, we thank you for
thank
what you're
you,
doing
Jesus.
In the lives
you,
of
Jesus.
The people that are watching tonight. Apostle, I just hear that God, I just keep seeing somebody's back. I just keep seeing someone's back.
Ooh,
and the Lord said he's healing your back.
Thank
he's
you,
healing
Jesus.
Your back.
Yes,
you're
going
to begin
thank
to feel
you,
a warmth just flow through your back. And you're going to be healed in the name of Jesus.
Thank
hallelujah.
You, Jesus.
Father, we thank you for it right now. Yes, God, we thank you, Lord, for that
thank
person,
you,
God, that's having problems with asthma, Lord, that can't breathe, Father.
Yes,
we thank
Jesus.
You, Lord, that you're healing them, God.
Thank
Lord,
you,
Lord, right
Jesus.
Now, Father God, you are healing them in the
yes,
name
Jesus.
Of Jesus.
God, she got
and I'm also
sight.
Seeing someone with neck problems.
Thank
oh,
you, Jesus.
Oh, yes,
yes,
I see
Jesus.
Someone with neck problems. God is
thank
healing
you, Jesus.
Them
glory
in the
to
name
God.
Of Jesus. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you are a miracle working God and that there's nothing too hard for you, Father God. Lord, we give you the glory and the honor and the praise. And there's also someone that needs a job. I'm hearing the Lord say this. God said, if you step out in faith and begin to look, God said, I'm going to open up a door for you. I'm going to just blow your mind. I'm going to give you a job that you thought you wouldn't even ever have. But God said, I am going to give it to you because you are a covenant person. You are not only in covenant with God, but you're in covenant with the body of Christ. And the Lord said, I'm obligated
come
in
on
this
now.
Covenant relationship
come on
to
now.
Move
obligated.
On your behalf, says
yes.
God. And you will have
thank
that job
you,
if you step out in faith.
I was hearing you when you said someone with a back problem, but this is in a different aspect of back. I heard God say, for somebody tonight, God said, I've got your back. I've got your back. The
wow.
enemy is
wow.
been trying to stab you in the back.
Wow.
Stab you in the back. But God said, I've got your back. I'm going to make you aware of that person or that individual that's trying to stab you in the back. And they may even be pretending to be your friend. But God said, I've got your back. I've
yes,
got your back. Be
yes,
sensitive
yes, yes.
to the voice of God.
Thank
be
you,
sensitive
Lord.
To the voice of God. Some of you have not listened to the voice of God. You have not listened to the voice of God. And the enemy, he's even put you in a place, he's made you vulnerable. He's put you in a place who has made you, and he's put you in a dangerous place. But God said, in my goodness and in my mercy, I'm going to protect you. I'm going to protect you. But hear my voice. Hear my voice to come out of that dangerous place, saith the Lord, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name tonight.
Hallelujah.
Oh, thank you, Lord. You have not, God said, you have not really understood covenant. You really have not embraced covenant. You really have not walked in covenant. You cannot walk with God in piecemeal. You got to sell out to God. You got to walk, sell out to God. Amen. Sell out to God. Be planted in the house of the Lord.
Yes.
Be kingdom people
Jesus.
In Jesus'
thank
name tonight.
You, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. You know, Apostle, kingdom people and covenant
thank you,
people
Jesus.
Are kingdom people.
Yes, they
and
are. Thank
blessings.
You, Jesus.
There's a blessing that
they're
comes
blessed
with
people.
Being in
thank
covenant
you, Jesus.
Relationship.
And
with others.
Thank
you know,
you,
when we make a covenant, we come in agreement that
thank
you know,
you,
whatever belongs to me belongs to you.
Yes.
You know, whatever belongs to
thank
God, the
you,
Lord
Jesus.
Jesus Christ belongs to us under the new covenant. So you need to step out in faith and claim it in the name of Jesus. Paul, I'm seeing that you're believing for a miracle. We're going to come in agreement with you for this miracle in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that you are the same yesterday, today and forever. You are still a miracle working God, and we believe you, God. We believe you, and we believe that we will see it in the name of Jesus. I'm also seeing this, Paula, that God is healing that high blood pressure. The Lord said that he's moving by his Spirit. spirit. God said, even right now, he's healing you in your body, in other areas of your body. And God said, I'm removing the stress, the stress, the stress, the stress. God said, I'm removing that stress that is behind that, says the Lord. And the Lord says, come up higher, come up higher. The Lord said, my desire for you is to come up higher. Come up higher in me, says the Lord, and you will see, says God.
Also, I'm hearing this from somebody else. God said, you've been in a hard place.
Yes.
You've been in a hard place. But God said, did not I say, I form the diamonds in the bowels of the earth. I formed it in the fires. Amen. But God said, I've been grooming you. I've been cutting. I've been sawing. Amen. I've been polishing. Yes, I hear God said, I've been polishing. And I've been polishing all those places that I cut and I made smooth. I'm making you my diamond. Amen. You've been a diamond in the rough. But God said, I've been forming you in my hands. I've been forming you in covenant relationships. I have not let you get away, said God. You looked at others and you've seen them. But God said, look at yourself in what I am doing. I am forming, and you are most precious. You're most precious in my eyesight, said God. Most precious in my eyesight. For I continue to form you for my will and for my purposes in the earth, saith the Lord. And I promise you, I will give you long life, saith the Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Someone on Periscope just asked if we were married.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah. Oh, we many, many, many years and for many, many, many more years.
That's right.
Amen. God gave me the love of my life. Amen. Hallelujah. You can't ask any better than that. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. All right. I think we're coming to the end.
Yes, let's just pray. Yeah, I just want to pray. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's the Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. It is the Lord.
Beautiful couple.
Amen.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you tonight for each and every one, Father, that is watching, Lord. We just thank you for their faithfulness, God. First of all, we thank you for their faithfulness to you, Father. But God, we also thank you, Lord, that you're watching over them, that you're performing every word that's being spoken tonight, Father God. Lord, would you speak blessings over each one, Father? We ask you to put the angels around each one and their families and protect them, Lord. Put a hedge around them, Father God. We pray for those that are sick in their bodies tonight, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, whatever it is, Father, if it's this virus or a cancer or a heart disease or whatever it is, Lord, we know that you're more than able. There's nothing too hard for you, Lord. And so, Father, we just decree supernatural healing.
Yes.
Supernatural healing. God, you're a supernatural God. And Lord, we know that you are moving by your spirit right now on behalf of America, Lord. We thank you, God, for what
yes,
you're doing,
thank
Lord.
You, Jesus.
Father, we believe that you're turning things around, Father. You're turning things around, Father God, for each and every person, Lord. What the enemy meant for evil, God, you're going to turn it around for their good, Father God. And Lord, we thank you for those covenant relationships that we have with each other, Father. We speak blessings over our covenant friends and our covenant family, Father God. And Lord, we just give you the glory and the honor and the praise for every good thing in our lives, Lord, because it's you, Father. It's you, Lord Jesus, and we give you the glory, God,
you know,
in Jesus' name.
Sometimes when God releases a word in a timely manner, and someone's asking about, are we married? Because we wouldn't be ministering. Yes, we are married over many years. But and I thought about how I met my wife, and I'm not going to take time, but just how that, bang, there she was. I was looking for a certain kind of wife, and I ruled out a lot of other wives. Amen. I was looking
other women,
for
huh?
other women. I was ruling out. I was telling God, even though I wasn't even saved at that time, but I was telling God what I was looking for in a wife, what I was looking for in a woman. And I was ruling out who I didn't want. Amen. I don't want this. I don't want that.
Thank
I don't
you,
want
Lord.
This. I don't want that. And God was gracious even to answer my prayers even when I didn't know the Lord. Amen.
Yes,
so he knew the plans he had for my life. And I'm saying this for a reason to release to somebody tonight, and maybe many tonight, if you don't have someone that is a husband, a wife, and you're looking for a godly man or a godly woman to be married to in God's time. I want you to know that God is able. Yes. God is able. Don't spend your life with people that's worthless. Amen. But ask God to bring somebody into your life that you're going to be able one day to receive them as your husband or wife. And you're going to live out the rest of your life serving the Lord Jesus Christ in the kingdom of God. Amen. So don't sell it for less. Amen. Don't just jump at anything that comes by. You, amen, deserve better than that. So amen. I'm going to release that word tonight. Whoever God may be talking to, there may be several. There may be one. There may be two. But listen, you have to carry yourself and present yourself as a godly woman, amen, for someone to want a godly woman, amen, because, amen. And so in Jesus' name, right now, Father, as I just release this word out to the audience, for those that are listening tonight, those that prepared themselves for a husband, like the bride has prepared themselves for the groom. So, Father, in Jesus' name, as you prepared yourself spiritually, and you're looking for that spiritual man or woman to labor beside you and with you, in Jesus' name, I've released this, and I sit in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
And for those that are saved, that's it. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Our thank saved. You, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just want to invite you
thank
to
you,
watch
Jesus.
Melissa and
yes.
me tomorrow morning at 11
yes.
o'clock. We're going to have a really good program.
Thank you, Jesus.
We're going to be talking about that God has a plan for you. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. God has a plan
and
for
also,
you.
And also, we want you to join us Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Pastor Edward will be speaking.
Yes.
And so, you know, we're just looking forward to God doing a lot of great and mighty things in the future for all of you and for all of us. Amen, Apostle.
Covenant people.
Yes, and Apostle and I Jesus. Will be back next Wednesday night at 7 o'clock.
Thank you,
hallelujah,
Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
All right.
Thank
God
you.
God bless you.
God bless you.
Thank
hallelujah.
You, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank
hallelujah,
you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.